1740, Maria Theresa, then just a girl of 23 years, became the first and only woman ever to rule in her own right as sovereign of the Habsburg dominions, a vast collection of kingdoms and lands that included most of Central and Eastern Europe. Also unusual for her time was the fact that she married for love, and among her many progeny included her 15th child, Marie Antoinette, the future Queen of France, and her great-great-grandson, the future Emperor Franz Joseph, and his consort, the Empress Elizabeth, known to us today by her nickname, Sisi. Now, after 2 years of very little travel, I decided to spend all of August in Europe to experience the Habsburg legacy myself. I started in the Habsburg port city of Trieste, where I was greeted by a huge statue of the still beloved Empress Sisi the moment I exited the train station. From there, I moved on to Salzburg to listen to some great music and make my grandmother endlessly jealous by hiking the Untersberg mountain, where Julie Andrews famously did her twirl at the beginning of The Sound of Music. From there, I went back to the Habsburg capital of Vienna, where I returned for the first time in almost 10 years. Got to go back to some of my favorite coffee houses and wandered through the Schönbrunn Palace, where a 6-year-old Mozart once famously entertained Maria Theresa in 1762, after which he jumped right into the lap of the Empress and gave her a huge kiss on the cheeks. Trieste, where by chance I realized that I was actually pretty close to the Dolomites. And so, on a whim, and with zero hiking gear in my possession, I decided to take a slight detour and headed to Castelrotto in South Tyrol. In case I had any doubt as to who used to own this land, every room in the hotel had a framed facsimile of an old map with this Latin inscription. After a good night's sleep, I woke up early the next morning for my first hike in Sassolungo, followed by the next day in Cicada. No, I did not bring my mountaining sticks, and yes, I did hike in business casual, but the views were totally worth it. Later in the year, I celebrated a milestone birthday, and I spent my birthday month with good wine and even better company with friends in Sydney, Singapore, and here in the States. Among my Bowdoin crew, we had not just one, not two, but three engagements this year. Sean and Eric, Kelsey and Martine, Sonny and Tom, I can't wait to celebrate with you all next year. Now onto the music. The piece you've been hearing was originally a soprano aria that comes in the middle of the famous hunting cantata written by Johann Sebastian Bach for a birthday celebration of a vassal duke of Maria Theresa's father. Drawing on themes from Roman mythology, the structure of the aria is simple, and yet Bach fills this idyllic pastoral scene with almost a hymn-like melody and a throbbing descending bassline, combined with a text that evokes the sheer joy of being alive. And I love that as a reminder to us all that life is a gift that we should always treasure. The next piece will take us into the mid-1800s, right around the time that Franz Josef and Sisi reigned. Composed by Robert Schumann, one of the great masters of German Romanticism, the Carnival is a musically complex and somewhat quirky set of 21 short pieces that portrays a masked ball from a carnival festival, where there is a hidden four-note cipher that underpins this whole piece like a huge musical puzzle. I'm gonna share the final two movements of this piece with you next. And with that, wherever you are spending the Christmas season this year, I wish you all the happiest of New Year's.